Anyway, thanks very much for this great turnout here tonight. I think record entry at the cross country at the weekend, record turnout here for one of our evenings. So shows the health of Scottish athletics, I think, in various shapes and forms. Anyway, apologies for me rambling on. You should have Ian Beattie here usually as MC, our race director. His car's bust, so he can't make it tonight, unfortunately. So I'll tell him someone clapped, yeah. forgive my ramblings for a couple of minutes. I just got to say the usual intros, and thanks to the hall here for having us. Thanks to all the sponsors, Ron Hill and Ultra Running Shoes, for their support for the race. And Lindsay's, of course, and if I've forgotten anyone else, I'm sorry. Run and Become, I guess you get a mention, but that's, I'm a bit biased on that one, yeah. The running order, we're going to have James up first, talking about how you should or shouldn't approach this race. He has a bit of experience in this area, so I'm told. And he can also, believe me, he runs for Great Britain, he can talk for Great Britain as well, so it should be quite entertaining. Then we're going to have Helen and John talking about how to crew, all the do's and don'ts of crewing. And then we'll have Sean, the medical man. And then we're going to have a short intermission. We can refill your glasses, go and have a little break, etc., before we come back for our wonderful and informative question time in the second half. Okay. Can I just ask, how many people here are running the West Line Away this year? Hands up. Quite a few of you. Good. How many are doing it for the very first time? Oh, how exciting. Yeah. How many of you are doing a shorter race, like a 50-mile or so this year, and just coming to find out what it's all about? Oh, quite a lot of you. Good. Don't be shy. And how many of you are these valued people, the support crew, just coming to find out how bonkers we all are? Yeah? Yeah, great. Good to see some of you. Great. Okay, let's give us a little bit of feedback so we know who we're pitching at. It's not everybody in the way, but that's good to know. Okay, so sit back, enjoy the journey, and in the event of any unhappenings, oxygen will not fall from below your seats or anything. The exits are in the corner there and the way you came in, I think, yes. There's a housekeeping announcement. Okay, over to James now.
Hello. Who's all doing this for the first time? Can you stand up? Could you stand up? Let's out them now. Everybody in the room should give everybody there a round of applause right now. It takes, you can sit down now, it's fine. Or you can stand up for the whole thing if you want. If I was standing in front of you, you'd still be able to see. Listen, it takes enormous courage and bravery to enter a race like this. I know it's not 100 miles, not exactly, but it's as near as damn it to 100 miles. And just by pressing, okay then, and then getting through that ballot is an exceptional feat in its own right. And obviously there's a lot of hard work and training ahead of you. So I hope tonight is useful for you. I'm going to talk for Great Britain. And Scotland and Europe, because we've not left yet. I'm going to talk for them all tonight, and then I'll get told to come off the stage in about 4 hours. So I hope you've all settled in and are ready to listen to me ramble. Adrian asked me to come along and to talk tonight because I did the West Highland Way. I've only ever done it once in 2016, and it's a big regret of mine. I gave away my goblet. I knew that would be a shock. I gave it away. I gave it to my dad for a start. There you go. Yeah. Yeah. And I've never seen it since. So it's not exactly taking pride of place in their living room. But anyway, and I did that to ensure that I would come back another day to earn a goblet for myself. So I gave it to my crew that day. There's actually someone from my crew who's doing it for the first time this year in the crowd. And that was so I would come back, and I'm coming back this year, and I'm really excited about it. And there was a load of things I wish someone had told me beforehand. So I'm hoping that I'll be able to impart some of that wisdom on you guys. So what did I do to prepare for my first attempt? There's a list up there, so I could leave you quietly to read that for 5 minutes and I could go and get a drink, or I'll actually step through them. First thing, I saw insight in lots of it. One of the things, Facebook, social media is brilliant for getting insight, but it's also very dangerous for leading you around rabbit holes. My first ultra that I ever did was a Clydeside. Anybody here done Clydeside? Yeah, my first ultra. Also my first DNF. So, you know, start as you mean to go on. I posted on Facebook before it, what gear should I take? And round about Strathclyde Park, I was regretting the three-piece suite I had in my bag. and the, you know, the six bottles of Tramadol and the bottle of whiskey to bribe the crew and all that. It was just horrendous because I just took every bit of advice and thought that I had to follow it all. Seeking insight is important, but you've really got to disseminate that down to what's important for you. So you get the classic, what shoes should I wear? And then everybody's like, you know, I mean, personally, I would suggest Hoka, but that's a personal preference thing. Which running becomes stock, just so you know. But, you know, you get lots of advice, but seek advice and then work out what's right for you. That's very important. And you'll get a lot of predominant, you know, voices who will come to you and they'll come back to you with their own opinions over and over again. There are people who do the West Highland Way running 30 miles a week. And there's people who do 150 miles a week. There's no right answer for these things except what's right for you. But getting lots of insight helps you make better decisions. Second thing, I made the race my focus one for that part of the season. And this is a personal view, but you can't blag the West Highland Way. I know Adrian did when the same year I did it, he got injured. What did you get injured, Adrian, about 15 miles in? Nearer 20. Oh, well, it wasn't as great a story as I thought. So he only done 75 miles on one leg. But you can't blag it. Adrian was able to do that because it was a focus for him and he was mentally engaged in the race and what have you. And making a focus isn't just a physical focus, but it's also a mental focus for you. So doing things like having a break planned for after it is something to look forward to make it worthwhile. And then also when you make it that focus, it makes it easier for the sacrifices you have to get involved in to do. So it becomes super important to you. So I made it everything. After I ran the 100K for Scotland there that year in March, everything I did was geared around the West Highland Way race, which was 3.5 months later. This third one is a really important one for me, is I ran the course, but I didn't do it every weekend. You see people are like, I'm running the West Highland Way, and then they're on it every week. They're running Mulgaty Drimmin every week. I'm like, oh my God, if I see Mulgaty Drimmin again and I've only done it like 4 times, I'll kill myself. But what you should do, if you can, and Dave, I was running with Dave McClure, I don't know if you heard of Dave McClure, I think he'd done all right in the race last year. Dave and I were running on Saturday, and we were talking about tonight, and Dave says, you really need to mention a night run. And I was like, yeah, I've got that in hand. And I made a note. A night run from Mulgaty to Balmahaa was exceptionally useful, I felt, if you've not ran on that terrain before in the dark, because it really does recreate the conditions you're going to run in the race. And if you're going to be someone who's maybe going about for a bit longer, maybe doing the same in the second half of the race somewhere, you know, maybe from Kinlochleven to Fort William, but try and recreate the conditions. So when you're running the course, try and recreate the conditions, but don't be on it. I mean, personally, I couldn't be on it. The Lochside, oh my God, if I see that Lochside again. But get to know the course so that you're familiar with the bits that might be tricky and so you know how you're going to feel on certain elements of it. And when I was running the course, I would tend to run it at the pace I intended running the race at. So obviously if I'm only running, say, 20 miles, it'll feel okay just doing 20 miles and I'll not come off the course a bit like, oh my, here we go, this course again. So that's a third bit of advice. I am a bit of an uber geek when it comes to numbers. So I'd planned splits and nutrition and tested them in training. I'm an uber geek. I had a guy crewing for me as an accountant. And he was like, you've only had 198 calories. You know, it was meant to be 200. And I'm like, holy neck. I'm not kidding you, by the way. But actually, doing that and then getting my crew involved, I know John and Helen have got much more experience in this stuff than I, but getting my crew involved in that plan was really, really, really useful. And I planned it with them and I sought their advice and I sought the advice of a few other people about the plan. And actually I changed the plan on the back of Paul Giblin's advice, and it was really useful because otherwise I'd probably have felt very different at a certain stage of the race if I hadn't. But I tested them in training, so that was the idea of running parts of the course at those paces so I would know whether they were realistic or not. I settled on my gear choices well in advance because you want to train in them. So if you're thinking, what will I wear? Will I wear a Salomon pack or will I wear this Ultimate Direction one? Again, both of which are available from Run and Become. I settled on that 3-4 months out from the race and then I used that to train in so I could get familiar with it and know what I was wearing and know how I was going to run. Even down to the pair of shorts I was going to wear, because the shorts I actually chose had a massive pocket in the back that I could fit a phone and a foil blanket in, which was really useful when you think about your mandatory kit that you need to have on the race. So just little things like that. So when you're thinking about what you're going to wear, I even tested the t-shirts I planned in wearing on the race day as well to make sure that they were all comfortable for me as well. And I had a brilliant crew with me who all knew how to work with me. If you're, who's crewing? Right. It is an absolute pleasure and a gift to crew people in the West Highland Warriors. It's like the day will pass by so quickly for you. Really will. Real. Hi, Lorna. I'm only playing back the feedback I've had from the guys who've worked with me, of course. None of them speak to me anymore, but on that day, having a crew who are totally dialed in, they're part of the team. Nobody wins this race on their own. You have a crew who look after you, and working with them so they know what to expect, to know what your trigger points are. So, you know, like if I'm not smiling and my head's down when I come into a checkpoint, it might mean I'm near death. So you need to kind of, you know, speak to me, make sure I'm okay. I'm a guy who wants to know every number, so I need to know. It's like, if somebody said to me, he's about 5 minutes behind you, I'd be like, well, is it four or is it six? You know, so the crew and you to work with me with that. Other people are a wee bit different. But get a crew who know you and work with them and love them and share the success with them. That's why I gave away my goblet to my dad. It was a special moment to win the race. So I was like, you have this goblet, and he's like, no bother. It's in about his car. So if I don't finish the race this year, I'll just get it out of his car when we finish. So those are like six, I could probably give you another 20 or 30, but those were six key things that I did to prepare for my first attempt. So what went well? What went well for me in the race was, thing number one, is I ran my own race from the outset. There was five guys who went out as if they'd been shot out of a cannon. And I was like, oh my God, I didn't realize this was a sprint. So I just let them go. And what was good about that was I got to run with Hal Corner, who's a total legend, and I got to run with him for about 13 miles. Then I kicked him in the knee, and I didn't make it by Ben Glass Farum, which was a shame, right? But anyway, such is life. But what it meant was, by the time I got to Ben Glass, four of them had dropped back, just naturally because they went too hard. They started racing at 1 a.m, and I'm like, why are you doing that? And of course, it's different from where you're at the front end or the back end, but the important thing is, do your own thing and don't get sucked into doing what someone else wants to do. And very early on, you'll be feeling okay. You'll be like, ah, it's okay, man, this is fine. It's faster than intended, but it's okay. Yeah, you've got another 90-odd miles to go, so don't get sucked into it. And that was a really important thing for me, and actually something I'll be making sure I do again this year, David. Just so you know, because I seen that video of you heading at Mulgaghy High Street the last year. David's still got the Strava segment record for train station to start at West Highland Way. And the scorch marks, I don't know if you've noticed the scorch marks. Yeah, you know. But seriously, do your own thing, and you'll look after yourself well. So that's thing number one. Thing number two, and this is something that's exceptionally, exceptionally important for me, is although I talked about planning and nutrition and all that stuff, have options. Because it came a point where actually what I'd planned to do, I couldn't do, but I had options. I have a go-to food and have a go-to thing I can do that if I can't get food into me, you know, I personally prefer to have solids for as long as I can and then just move on to whiskey and Coke. When it gets to the point where I've moved on to the Coke, there's no way back from that. That's me, I'm on liquid basically for the rest of the race. So I don't want to do that too early. So I have that's my contingency plan, but have a plan that you can go to alternatives and think about them in advance and test them if you can. And that went really well for me. To the point whereby, where was it, Scott? Was it, it was Glencoe, wasn't it? I started moving on to the juice. Not the juice as in what Lance Armstrong took, by the way, because that's not allowed. I'm talking juice as in this, what Scottish people call ginger. So that was really important for me as well, and having that was incredibly powerful. Third thing, which is again really important, is have a word with yourself. When you're feeling down, and you're feeling like things are tough, and what went really well for me, I was always able to stay in the moment. What you're doing is going to hurt like hell. I take it you know this, right? Yeah, it's not like, oh my God, it's going to be sore. Yeah, it is. And you'll probably lose toenails and all that kind of good stuff, but you'll have a good sleep the week after. Being able to stay in the moment was one of the things that helped me win the race in 2016. So rather than panicking about what was happening around me, and I actually got a wee bit lost, which is not usual for me. I got a wee bit lost at one point just because there was a van parked over a turn off that I wasn't familiar with because I hadn't been on the course enough. Instead of panicking at that moment, I took time to collect myself. And I'm kind of going to tell you a story. Some of you might have heard this before, but my race boiled down to how I managed my mindset over 10 seconds. 10 seconds. So what happened was, I'd unexpectedly taken the lead after Chris Jones had went the wrong way. Chris Jones went the wrong way somewhere between Bridgeorkie and, Tinsman and Bridgeorkie. And because I'd put my crew down and got them to point an arrow up a hill. And it worked. It was like, you know, like Acme arrows. So off he went. Didn't see him again until later on. And so that was unexpected. So I went from being the hunter to the hunted. And I went into defensive mode, which was the wrong thing to do because I was running really well. I was chasing him down. I'd went from being 20 minutes behind him to actually right up his jacksie. But then I went from the hunter to hunted and I went into defensive mode, so much so that I then got to Kinloch leaving and the lead I had over the guy in second had went down to 4 minutes. And you know that climb at Kinloch leaving, I think better known as that bastard climb at Kinloch leaving. I ran halfway up that and that was actually a ton off a miss. It was a van parked over the entrance to the trail. Also the one that I made a total back end of coming in the Pylon experience this year, but we'll not talk about that either, or the Pylon endeavour. So I kind of looked back, I lost a couple of minutes trying to find the trailhead, got back on, and then halfway up the hill, I just decided I'd lost the race. And I was like, oh, I can't run here, and I'm in agony, and it's all too hard, and it's really warm, and what have you, and I'd lost the energy for whatever reason. So I hiked the second half of that hill, basically muttering under my breath and swearing and cursing everybody. And then I got to the top, and you know the view at the top of that hill, the 360 view? Does everybody know that view I'm talking about? Who doesn't know that view? You're in for a treat. Because you're standing there and you've got the Munros left and right, and if you turn round, you can look down Kinloch leaving, and you can see the town and you can see the lock. And it was a beautiful sunny day and there was loads of people out with their backpacks on and all that stuff. But I'm in a funk and I'm standing there and I'm like, right, where is Adam? He's the guy in second place. Where is he? I'm just waiting him overtaking me. It's like, and I'm starting to make excuses for losing the race. So I gave myself 10 seconds, and I gave myself a 10-second countdown. So why would I give it a countdown and not a count up? Anybody know? It's a psychological trick. Once you get to zero, you have to make a choice. I asked myself a question, and the question was this, was, are you prepared to hurt like you've never hurt before to have the lasting glory of winning the West Highland Way, or are you just going to feel sorry for yourself for the next 2 and a bit hours and say hi to Adam as he passes by and make your excuses about why you failed? And that's what I felt like at the time. So I counted down 10 to 0, and then just as someone passed me, I shouted an expletive with it after it at the top of my voice, and I ran as hard as I could. And in those 10 seconds, I went from losing the race because I was feeling sorry for myself to winning it. And if you could, that went really well for me because I work on that a lot. And if you can get your mind in a strong place, it will see your body through. So if you could do anything, work on that. And that's something that I want to leave you with what went well. What didn't go so well? And what would I change? I was really lucky in the sense that my race went pretty well on the day. There wasn't too much it would change, but I was a bit ambitious with some of my splits. And when I was outside of them, it really started to grind me a wee bit. So one thing I definitely will change is that I will have windows to land in, as opposed to I will be at, you know, Balmaha by this time in the morning. I'll land in there somewhere between these times and have a bit more tolerance in my plan, because then I'll be more comfortable and I'll be going, all right, well, I'm a wee bit behind the window where I want to be, so I'll just work harder in this section and I'll be a wee bit more relaxed about it. What else would I change? This is a difficult one. There was a couple of nutrition choices that I made that I think I went on to liquids too early. And I think that was part of the reason I kind of ended up with a wee bit of energy loss as I was going over the hills because I was relying on Coke. I should have thought that going up the Divil, because I'm not going to run that, I should just have a good bite to eat and take the time to enjoy a bite to eat up there as I'm going up the Divil. And then the last thing that I would change, and it didn't go so well, was when I was running early in the race, I should have just done my own, I should have listened to music and not get involved in some of the conversations that I was getting involved in, because actually it was starting to put me off a wee bit, and I wanted to just do my own thing. Now I know some people have run it social, but when I do the race this year, for anybody that might be running alongside of me, I'm not really going to speak to you, because whilst I like standing in front of you and talking and all that, I'm actually quite antisocial in the trails, and I was getting taken away from that, so it was distracting me a wee bit. Even though I really enjoyed running with Hal, that was an education. And he got mega pissed on a Saturday night, didn't he? I was like, oh, I wish I'd get injured, you know. So I wouldn't change too much, but that's because I got really lucky. If you ask me for any other race, like the Autumn 100 this year, where I twisted my ankle after 5 minutes and then had to drop out after 40 miles, I shouldn't have worn road shoes in the trails. That's what I'd change there. But hey, we all live and learn. So I've already talked about the 10 seconds that saved my race. And just to get back to that, is there anyone in here who practices any mental mind games or anything they do in order to help them with that kind of stuff? Adrian, you obviously do a lot of meditation, Adrian, and stuff, yeah? Yeah. Either that, you always look bored when I'm talking to you. It's one of the two. It's like, I'm just meditating, James. I'm like, okay, that's brilliant, Adrian, usual. Anyone else? I didn't see many. I remember you messaged me. Was it after the West Highland Beer? You messaged me after that, and so Donna's thing said you are wonderfully awesome, and we can replace wonderful with anything. And messaged me after the race to say that got you through at certain points. And just those little things, like those mantras, those little things can make a big difference. So if you take nothing away from what I'm talking about, forget about do hell reps and speed work and all that stuff. Where you can make a massive difference, and don't forget about it, actually you should do it, but where you can make a massive difference isn't out in the trail or it isn't out in the hills, it's in your head, and spend some time working on that. It's really worthwhile. Right, okay, I've questions. Adrian, how long have I got? Well, take a couple of questions. Oh, 100%. See, I mean, anybody who knows me will talk to me about running, is recovery is the most important part of training. Honestly, if I could reach through phone apps and you see people have run an ultra on a Saturday and then they're on the Monday and they're like 10 miles, felt shit, and I'm like, I wonder why that might be. Might have been that ultra you done on Saturday. So yeah, I mean, after an event like the West Highland Way, I will take a minimum of a week without running, minimum. And then even then, for the 2 or 3 weeks after that, I'll be like gently easing back in. And what I won't do is I'll never ever pile A race on at top of A race. You see these guys are doing like, this is my 7th ultra of the year, look at me, you know, and you're like, okay, let me know when you're injured and then we'll have a conversation about it. Yeah, recovery is massively important. And of course, it's not that alone that gets you injured, but it's a cumulative effect. So minimum for me, and I'm doing the race in June, I'll take a minimum a week off, and actually I'm going to Spain for a week after that, and I'm all inclusive. So it'll be the two C's, as they say in Spain, cake and cerveza. Yeah. An ultra, I mean, you'll get people who'll go like tailwind, or they'll then go into like beta fuel. I mean, I've been trying beta fuel. I can't really get on with it, actually. But the ultimately what you need to get is a mix of slow release and fast release carbs, right? So you get the instant hit, but you've also got something that's going to sustain you. And I mean, you take Debbie. Debbie isn't here, isn't it? No, Debbie Kinsani will run 100 mile or on coke alone. Yeah. And you've got other people who are like, you went at the Euros this year. My dad was crewing for the crew this year at the European Championships in Romania. It's like 36 degrees, 70% humidity during the day, and somebody asked for a beef Wellington. And he got it. He got it in Romania. I mean, this is a guy who lives in Croy, right? So he's going to boot like any beef Wellington, mate. And this guy in Romania is like, whatever. But for some people, it's something that sustained them like that. But the mix, it's ideally a mix. And I mean, most people will find it easier to ingest it through liquid. Because obviously it'll get easier and you're not having to chew and you don't end up with a cotton mouth, you know, where your mouth's dry and stuff. Yeah, gels, I just find them, if I try and take them for too early. So for me, what I will use at the West Highland Way, so I'll tell you what I'll use, will be a mix of Tailwind, which I mix with SIS, just because I like the two of them together. Better not tell Mike Julian that. I will use home bacon to augment that. So sweet potato brownies, I talk about them all the time, but they're brilliant, right? Home baking, sweet potato brownies, make little carb balls as well, which you can make with like dates and nuts and throw some dark chocolate and stuff in with. And another thing that I make is like mint chocolate biscuits. Remember him, Scott? Because I think you ate most of them, didn't you? Mint chocolate biscuits, which are brilliant for giving you that kind of hit and fresh feeling, like you brush your teeth. And then cold. Is that me?
It's you. Okay, James, thank you so much.
Thank you.